He said to have fellowship. So I was enjoying that fellowship. So, but he told me I was up next. So here I am. Is that echoing to you too? Okay. Just as long as I'm not losing my mind. These gentlemen have Bibles in their hands. If you need one this morning, just slip up your hand. They'll make sure that you receive one today. And we are in Joshua chapter 23. Joshua chapter 23 this morning. I was relieved when I walked into the auditorium this morning. I don't know about you. How many of you have dreams on a regular basis? I mean, like a regular basis. Like that's me. I have a dream. It just seems like every single night. And I can usually remember them, you know, like into the past. So last night, I had this nightmare. I was listening to the music group warming up for this morning's service. And I was so relieved when I walked in this morning and saw the orchestra up here in front, and not you two. So my nightmare was, I was out in the foyer, and I heard this rock band warming up in here. And I mean, the whole place was starting to shake. Now, it's amazing how God deals with your brain and how things intersect. But back in 1984, we did a church plant. We were in Syracuse, New York. And every Saturday night, the devil would pay me a visit in one shape or form or another. And so there I was that Saturday night, and I'm listening to this loud music. And I thought to myself, who in the right mind has their music playing this loud? It's 11 o'clock at night. I'm trying to go to sleep. I can't go to sleep. Finally, it's midnight. Finally, it's like 12 o'clock at night. And I thought to myself, I'm going to call the police. So I called the police, and they said, well, where do you live? And I told them where I lived. And they said, well, what you're hearing is you too. They're down at the Carrier Dome downtown. I was a half a mile away. And I could hear it so loud, I couldn't even get to sleep. So in my nightmare last night, it was you two was here, and they were just, I mean, the whole place was moving. And I thought to myself, this is not how we worship Jesus. And I was so upset by that. And I woke up, and I thought to myself, oh, this is terrible. And then I went, oh, it's a nightmare. Good, go back to sleep. So I woke up, and then I came in this morning. Like I said, as soon as I saw that trombone, I said, hallelujah. I'll tell you. We are in Joshua chapter 24 this morning, and it is a blessing. This is the last message here in Joshua. Ken Mahon, who is going to be here for the teen lockout this coming weekend, Friday, Saturday, will actually be preaching here. We'll start a new series for the summer on Mother's Day, so the week after that. So stay tuned to information about that. Joshua chapter 24, again, is the last one. I encourage you to keep in prayer situations overseas where I'll be heading in June. I sent an email out to everyone this week and had asked you to pray for a gentleman who was arrested, and it just was the best news ever that you know, they detained him, but they did not detain him for reasons of faith in Jesus Christ. It was totally a business way. This is how they do business deals in countries like that. They want to renegotiate the deal. They just decide, and then they throw you in jail, and they renegotiate from there. You tend to see it their way, don't you, when that happens? Yes, you really tend to. And so that was their way of doing that, and so it was unfortunate. And then I found out yesterday, or actually the day before yesterday, that they can do other things too. They just decided to cancel my flight back. And so I got an email from Expedia saying, you can't come back that day. You'll have to come back another day. And so yesterday I was on the phone dealing with that. And so, no, they don't have to refund your money. So you tend to see things their way. So, yahoo. Well, let's see it God's way this morning as we go to Joshua chapter 24, shall we? Joshua chapter 24, Joshua gathered all the tribes of Israel to Shechem, and he called for the elders of Israel and for their heads and their judges and their officers, and they presented themselves before God. And Joshua said to all the people, thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, from ancient times your fathers lived beyond the river, namely Terah, the father of Abraham and the father of Nahor, and they served other gods. And I took your father Abraham from beyond the river and led him through all the land of Canaan and multiplied his descendants and gave him Isaac. To Isaac I gave Jacob and Esau, and to Esau I gave Mount Seir to possess it. But Jacob and his sons went down to Egypt. And I sent Moses and Aaron, and I plagued Egypt by what I did in its midst. And afterward I brought you out. I brought your fathers out of Egypt, and you came to the sea, and Egypt pursued your fathers with chariots and horsemen to the Red Sea. But when they cried out to the Lord, he put darkness between you and the Egyptians and brought the sea upon them and covered them. And your own eyes saw what I did in Egypt. And you lived in the wilderness for a long time. And then I brought you into the land of the Amorites who lived beyond the Jordan. And they fought with you, and I gave them into your hand. And you took possession of their land when I destroyed them before you. And then Balak, the son of Zippor, king of Moab, arose and fought against Israel. And he sent and summoned Balaam, the son of Beor, to curse you. But I was not willing to listen to Balaam, so he had to bless you, and I delivered you from his hand. You crossed the Jordan and came to Jericho, and the citizens of Jericho fought against you. And the Amorite, and the Perizzite, and the Canaanite, and the Hittite, and the Girgazite, and the Hivite, and the Jebusite. And I gave them into your hand. And then I sent the hornet before you, and it drove out the two kings of the Amorites from before you. But not by your sword or your bow. I gave you a land on which you had not labored, and cities which you had not built, and you have lived in them. You are eating of vineyards and olive groves which you did not plant. That, my friends, is an awesome legacy, the greatness of our God towards his people. Let's remember that legacy. And let's understand that Joshua as well is going to speak of his legacy. And as well, we will be challenged with regard to our own legacy this morning. Shall we pray? God, we just give you thanks and praise for the many, many blessings that we have in Christ Jesus today. Father, even as a Christian in the New Testament age, as the age of grace, I cast my eyes back to the Old Testament and I see your mighty works. Father, we never tire of looking at all the great things your hands have done. May we be encouraged today for the legacy that you had towards your people Israel is a legacy that will continue on through the millennial kingdom. And Father, today I pray that as children in the body of Christ, in this unique situation we find ourselves in the church, may we understand the significance of following you. And may we honor you, Lord, in the legacy of life, I pray, in Christ's name. Amen. It's amazing the things that God has done, isn't it? And isn't it wonderful when you read through that passage, when you stop and you think about how phenomenal our God truly is? Our God is an amazing, amazing God. He has done so many things. When I think of all the things that God had done by taking Abraham out of the Ur, calling him out of the Ur of the Chaldees, and bringing him to this new land, I stand amazed. When I think of all of the things that transpired, you know, the mentioning there of Isaac, and we think of how amazing that miracle was that Abraham and Sarah could at an old age have a child. And not only that child, but to be challenged to sacrifice that child and then to be able to see that child grow up and go on and then the descendants beginning to grow outward from that. Our God is an amazing God. He brings them through the land and he takes them through all of the enemies that were listed. And you can look at that map there. And that map is a testimony to the greatness of our God, because God gave victory to the people of Israel. Not a warring people, not a people skilled in combat or any type of military strategy. But he gives to them a land flowing with milk and honey and allows them to take places of residence that they did not even build. A land that had already begun to grow wonderful olive trees and had flourishing plants, enough that the people of Israel could walk right in and begin to eat. Our God is a great God. And for the people of Israel, they needed to be challenged to see how great Almighty God truly is. And so we see the legacy here of the Lord as it begins to unfold. And Joshua is at that point in his life now where he is concerned about what is going to happen to the people of Israel. Let's remember what's going on. You remember when God came to Joshua and said, "You're old, you're advanced in age." Now, when God tells you that, you know the end is near, right? And so Joshua knew that. And Joshua has now, at the very end, brought the people together. Now, theologians have looked at chapter 24 of Joshua, and they see patterns of a covenant treaty as the people of Israel are gathered together. So Joshua pulls the people together. You'll notice here on the map that place called Shechem. Do you see Shechem? Shechem is right here. And incidentally, this area here was noteworthy because it goes all the way back to the place where the first covenant was made between God and Abraham over in Genesis chapter 12. It was a Levitical city. It was a city of refuge. It was a place that God had prepared for the burial of the bones of Joseph. And it is interesting because it actually is a place located between Mount Ebal and Mount Gerizim, where you had the blessings and the cursings. Do you remember the blessings and cursings? And God said to the people of Israel, if you are going to be blessed, this is what you're going to do. And if not, this is how you're going to be cursed. And so there was that time when the people met there. Remember, that was an odd situation. Joshua, it seemed, had the opportunity to go and work out militarily a great advance against the enemy, and instead he diverts the people of Israel up to those mountains so that they can hear from God. So Shechem is a special place in many ways. And so Joshua has pulled everyone together. It's the end of his life. And what he's most concerned about is the future spiritually of the people of Israel. He's not concerned about what's going on in the land. God is going to bless them. He's going to take care of all their needs, but it's going to depend on one solitary thing, and that is their faithfulness to Almighty God. At this point in time, the people have done some good things. They've also been very inadequate tribe-wise in taking the lands that were given to them. Many did not fully drive out the occupants. And because they hadn't fully driven out the occupants of the land, they'd begun to take spiritually the bad things from the people who were occupying the land. And it began to corrupt the people. And Joshua is old now, and he's looking at the end of his life, and he's thinking to himself, all this could be for nothing. I want you to stop and think about that. We have the Lord's legacy here. All the amazing things. Folks, I never get tired of reading the end or the verse there in verse 12 of chapter 24. And I sent the hornet before you, and it drove out the two kings of the Amorites. Do you remember that when we were in that section? Wasn't that a fabulous, fabulous encounter? They had no way to get rid of those two big, huge giants, Sion, Og. And God said, I'll take care of them. And he brings a hornet. These are some of the amazing things that God has done. Crossing the Jordan River at flood stage, going up to Jericho and that great city, that fortified city, and to march around it and then call upon the Lord, and down go the walls, and victory is theirs. God turning enemy upon enemy and confusing them. All the while, the people of Israel being victorious. Could all this be for nothing? Could all this be for nothing? Joshua has legitimate concerns, if you ask me. I believe as he looks at this, he realizes that there is no guarantees. Because God had, at that point of Mount Ebal and Mount Gerizim, instructed the people that if they wanted to be blessed, they needed to continue on a pathway that showed that they were faithful to the Lord. And what Joshua is remembering is that all of this can be for naught if the people turn away from the Lord. The Lord has done great things. What will be the future of Israel? What Joshua wants to do next pertains largely to his own legacy, because we see here that he is going to make a very bold statement, and maybe you have it written on the wall of your home. In verse 14, he says, "Now therefore fear the Lord and serve him in sincerity and truth." And that is so, so important. What God is saying through his man Joshua is that the focus of the people needs to be that they fear the Lord. There needs to be that fear of the Lord. That is at the basis of following God. For the Old Testament believer, he first had to come to a point where the fear of the Lord was the beginning of wisdom. We stop and we think of ourselves today and we think about our love for the Lord. It seems that we're more driven to understand that in that type of quote, you know, that type of parentheses, that we love the Lord. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your might. The people of Israel here are being told, "I want you to serve me, but I want you to fear me first." There needs to be at the foundation a healthy fear of the Lord. This is the same God who drove those hornets down onto those giants. It's a great idea to fear the Lord. And in fact, I think that today it's healthy for us as followers of Christ to fear God as well. Yes, we're under his mercy. And yes, we're under his blessing. But we should never take for granted the relationship that we have with our God. Joshua is going to go on and he's going to say some interesting things. He says, you need to serve him with sincerity and truth. The idea here of having this type of integrity, depending how your Bible version may parse this out, some would say loyalty and truth, sincerity and truth, integrity and truth. The word really connotes the idea, first of all, of wholeness, blamelessness, integrity. And it's a term of passion. They are to be absolutely and totally passionate about their God. There needs not to be any confusion here. What God expects from his people, Israel, is that they would be fully committed to him. Fully committed to him. Without any question. I'm a follower of Jehovah. 110%. This would go a long way. God's not asking for much, in my mind. Look at all the great things that he has done for his people. He has placed them into this land. He has conquered these enemies. He has driven them out from before them. And is it too much to ask for the people of Israel to be 100% committed to him? Fear him, serve him in sincerity and truth. No hypocrisy. No smoozing around the truth. But straight up, here's the truth. Notice what Joshua goes on to say. He says, "And put away the gods which your fathers served beyond the river and in Egypt, and serve the Lord." That's a curious statement there, isn't it? He's telling the people of Israel. Now, it was my understanding that the people of Israel were following the Lord, that incrementally through this seven-year process of taking the land, they were checking their hearts regularly. When you stop and you think about some of the sin that went on, remember Achan, who hid those certain items under his tent floor? And you remember the massive trouble that he got into? I think the people of Israel were fairly careful in how they went about serving the Lord. What's happened? What here has happened? It's a legitimate question that we need to ask. But something has occurred that's not good. And as Joshua looks at the issue of the legacy of these people, he wonders what their future might be. He says, if it is disagreeable in your sight to serve the Lord, choose for yourselves today whom you're going to serve. Whether the gods of your fathers that they serve beyond the river, the gods of the Amorites, whose land you now are living, you're going to have to make that choice. If it seems disagreeable, if it seems evil, what he's saying there, if it seems unjust that you serve just the one Jehovah God, if it's unreasonable or inconvenient, he says, you need to choose. You go back to that picture that is up here. Isn't that a great picture for making a choice? You're mountain biking along this country road, and you've got to go one way or the other. And if you choose the wrong way, there is going to be massive consequence. You're going to need to choose. Which is it going to be? Up until this time, God did all the choosing. In fact, this is the first time in the Old Testament you're going to find that God is giving the people a choice. Other than going back to the Garden of Eden where Adam and Eve had a choice, here you have the people being called upon. Who are you going to choose? Are you going to choose me, or are you going to choose these other small g gods? If it seems evil to you, it seems disagreeable, if it's not fair, you make the choice. And then he says this. He says to them, if you make the wrong choice, you're not going to be able to serve God like you think you might be able to. I think I lost a slide somewhere in there. I want you to notice here at the end of verse 15 that what Joshua makes the statement of, he says, if it's disagreeable for you, you make the choice. But at the end of verse 15, he says, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. We'll serve the Lord. Joshua's legacy is absolutely cemented. He has made the decision that for him, he is not going to be interested in serving these other gods. It doesn't seem disagreeable at all to him. It seems like it is his reasonable service. Where have we heard that before? Romans chapter 12. It's reasonable to him. Look at all the wonderful things God has done. Of course, we're not going to serve the false gods that were present there in Egypt, things that the people of Israel had carried along with them in their heritage. Or are we going to delve into this false god worship that was pertaining to the Amorites that lived here before us? I'm going to serve the Lord, he says. This is an important aspect for me. In verse 19, if you go down with me to verse 19, Joshua makes an amazing statement. Joshua makes a statement concerning legacy living. Living a life that is really worth living. He makes a statement that introduces a deep paradox. It is one of the most shocking statements in the Old Testament. Truly a bombshell. Joshua says to them, you will not be able to serve the Lord, for he is a holy God. He is a jealous God. And he goes on to say further, he will not forgive your transgression or your sin. You say, wait a minute. Wasn't he just pleading with the people here to serve the Lord? How is it now he says to them, well, you can't really serve the Lord? How do you work this out? How do you balance this? How do you put this in perspective? How are we to understand verse 19? What is Joshua speaking to? Well, you remember back in verse 14 that he says to them, you're going to need to put away those false gods. He says, put them away. Literally, it means to throw them away, to cast them aside. On down a little bit further, Joshua says to them in verse 22 that verse 20, if you forsake the Lord and serve foreign gods, then he'll turn and do you harm and consume you after he has done good to you. And the people said, no, but we will serve the Lord. And Joshua says, your witnesses against yourselves that you have chosen for yourselves the Lord to serve them. And they said, we are witnesses. And up until this point, everything seems agreeable until Joshua points out their serious sin. In verse 23, he says, now therefore put away the foreign gods which are in your midst and incline your hearts to the Lord, the God of Israel. The only other place that I find that the word there for inclining your hearts is used of Solomon, who inclined his hearts towards the foreign gods of his wives. To go that direction. You see, the problem with the people of Israel was that while they hadn't rejected Jehovah Jireh as their God, they were adopting other gods as idols. And what Moses dealt with, going all the way back to the people pre-wandering, is similar to this, in the sense that these people wanted to be syncretistic. When Moses is up on the mountain and he comes down and the people have made a golden calf, if you ask those people, I am presuming, they would not have said that they have rejected any belief in the Almighty true God. But what they were doing was they were thinking to themselves how wonderful it would be if we covered our bases more fully and added to our repertoire of gods. They'd become syncretistic in their worship of God. And what God is saying is, I am a holy God and I am a jealous God, and this doesn't work for me. It is in no way palatable. This is not an arrangement that continues on whereby the people of Israel will be blessed. I don't believe that they were setting up altars to Baal during this time period. Because Joshua, as the leader, and the elders that are under him would not have stood for it. But what the people were doing is they were setting up in their houses false gods. If you go back to Exodus chapter 20, God tells the people, thou shalt have what? No other gods before me. There's only supposed to be one true God. The more you get to know God, the more you realize that God is truly a jealous God. He is not to be shared. And among the people of Israel, they needed to determine what is their legacy going to look like. Because what Joshua has told them previous is, if you forsake the Lord, you serve the foreign gods, he's going to turn and do you harm and consume you. When you're consumed, where are you? I don't know. Is that a tough question? You're gone. The legacy's over. You don't pass anything down. It's done. The people of Israel were in a very difficult place because they were being challenged to look at their own walk with God. And they were being called back to fear him and now serve him with sincerity and truth. And when they came about to Joshua and they said, oh yeah, Joshua, we're going to follow the Lord. Absolutely. We're on the same page with you. We're going to get those plaques and we're going to put them up on our walls too. As for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. How many have one of those plaques in your house? Hey, man, see, a whole bunch of us do. Yeah, I do too. It's the coolest thing. But here's the reality. The challenge comes back to them because Joshua knows what they're doing in reality. And this is where the sincerity and truth part comes in, you see. There were idols that were a big part of their life. They'd become merged together, not unlike what we see in Africa right now, where we have many people and a lot of mission work that's going on. I was recently at our Central Africa Baptist College board of directors meeting last week in Pennsylvania, this past week. I don't know where the days have gone. And it was pretty amazing. You know, we talk about Africa, and we see some really great things happening there in Africa. And we have some really sharp students there in the college that are so excited about going off and serving the Lord. And it's fun to look at the graduates and what they're doing now in Africa, sharing the gospel, starting churches. And it's wonderful to see what's going on. But you have to be very careful, because many in Africa like the idea, when they hear of Jesus, to place Jesus into their life. But it doesn't mean for them that they're going to cast out all of the other idols in their life for fear that if they did that, it would bring about some type of bad circumstance for them. And so they're not fully trusting in Jesus if that's the case. Now, we understand it better in context of works versus grace for salvation. But understanding in the context of works and grace for salvation, understanding that there's no good works, not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy he saved us. Think back into the Old Testament, when the Old Testament people were holding on to their false idols while also embracing Jehovah God. What did they really have? They had nothing. And this will continue on throughout the book of Judges. And in the book of Judges, you'll find that once the people of Israel got to the end, and we find here that Joshua is going to die later in this chapter, and they buried him in the territory of his inheritance, the Bible says, and Israel served the Lord all the days, verse 31, of Joshua, and all the days of the elders who survived Joshua, and had known all the deeds of the Lord which he had done for Israel. And they buried the bones of Joseph, which the sons of Israel brought up from Egypt at Shechem, in a piece of ground which Jacob had bought from the sons of Hismer. And we find here the father of Shechem for 100 pieces of money. Eleazar, the son of Aaron, died. They buried him too. And you could see what was going on. By the time we come to Judges, we come into a very dark spiritual time. And you know the cycle that goes on there in Judges. I've shared that with you before. This is what's at stake. What is going to happen with the people of Israel? Are they this day going to be true to this? Now notice what in verse 24 Joshua does. The people said to Joshua, "We will serve the Lord our God, we'll obey his voice." That's great news. That is great news. And so Joshua says, so Joshua made a covenant with the people that day and made for them a statute and an ordinance in Shechem. And Joshua wrote these words in the book of the law of God, and he took a large stone and set it up there under the oak that was by the sanctuary, probably by the tabernacle of the Lord. And Joshua said to all the people, "Behold, this stone was going to be a witness against us, for it has heard all the words of the Lord which he spoke to us, and thus it shall be for a witness against you, so that you do not deny your God." And Joshua dismissed the people, each to his own inheritance or to his tribal heir. What has happened here has been that Joshua wanted to establish a covenant with these people who are saying, "Yes, we will follow the Lord." And so he writes it on a stone. They used to whitewash those stones, and then they'd write on them. You could see them from miles away. This was going to be something that the people of Israel would look at. And they would realize that God was saying that if you break this covenant, there is going to be judgment. My hand of blessing will be taken away from you. It's pretty serious, isn't it? God's desire is to bless his people. There is no question about that. But what he says to them is that you say, "We will serve the Lord," Joshua says, but you can't. What he means there is that while there is a split allegiance in a person's life, they cannot serve the Lord. And my understanding is, while God wasn't expecting perfection out of his people, what he did expect was 100% devotion to him. God knows that we're not perfect. He's done a lot of work to allow us to have a relationship with him in our imperfect situation we find ourselves in. People of Israel, do you remember? Stop and think about it. The people of Israel would sin. Did they sin on a regular basis, the people of Israel? Anybody? Pretty often, right? I mean, if any indication by the sacrificial system is given, they sinned a lot. But God gave them a way to have those sins covered and have a right relationship with him. Isn't that wonderful? And you and I, as followers of Jesus Christ today, while we're not perfect either, God says, I've given you a way to maintain a right relationship with me as well. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Where God would say to us, no, Kevin, you can't serve me. I'm not going to forgive you for your transgression and your sin, is if there is known sin in my life that I am clinging to and refusing to repent of. Do you follow me? That's why Joshua said to the people of Israel, you can't serve the Lord, because they had these idols in their very homes. And the first thing, if they really mean it, that they're going to choose the Lord and honor him, the first thing they did when they got home was to get that idol and burn it, break it, smash it, and destroy it. How important it is for us to understand the significance of our sin. I meet people all the time who say that they're serving the Lord, and yet there is major areas of their life that are not being dealt with. They're accepting those areas. They're enjoying those areas. They're hanging on to that sin. They're clutching it tightly, and they refuse to give it up. But all the while, they'll turn and say, oh, yes, I love the Lord. I serve the Lord. Now, don't misunderstand. God wants to embrace them. But because he is holy, because he is jealous God, they must come to him and cast off that sin. I am not perfect. I know no one other than Jesus who ever was. But what our God expects from us today as members of the body of Christ is a devotion, a love to him. Loving him with sincerity and truth. Understanding that if I'm holding on to sin in my life, that if I'm holding on to that which God hates, I am incapable of serving him. I am saying that I'm loving him so that you could hear it. But if he knows in my heart that there is a deep, dark secret that I refuse to deal with, it is impossible for me to serve the Lord. Too many Christians today are carrying around a dark secret, pretending to serve the Lord. Now, I know there's nobody here like that, because you all got out of bed this morning, came here at 9 o'clock, right? I mean, I'm preaching to the choir, as they used to say. We're all sinners, aren't we? We're all sinners, and we have a sin nature. How easy it is for us to get sideways in our relationship with God. What God doesn't need is more religious people in the world. What God wants is people who are seeking him in sincerity and truth. He knows you're not perfect. That's why Jesus died on the cross. He's sealed you unto the day of redemption. 1 Corinthians chapter 6. Read through 1 Corinthians chapter 6. How wonderful it is when you go through And at the very end, he begins to talk about our bodies. You know, our bodies are pretty significant. Do you realize that? Let's look at that. We have time. I just looked up there and realized I got 12 more minutes. Y'all thought you were going for breakfast. If you got to leave, you can go ahead. 1 Corinthians chapter 6. Notice with me there in verse 14. Now God has not only raised the Lord. Now what's that speaking about there? It's speaking about the resurrection of Jesus, correct? And he says this, but he will also raise us up through his power. I'm looking forward to that. I've shared that with you in the past. But I know that even though my body one day will die, that it's not done. That's a very key point in Christianity. God is not through with your body when it takes its last breath. While I will sing hallelujah silently on my way up to glory, I'm happy that my body has died because my sin nature has died with it. But I understand that my body will be raised in incorruption. It will put on immortality. He says this, do you not know that your bodies, he's on the subject of bodies. Are you with me? Bodies, it's all about bodies, your flesh and blood. You say, oh, my flesh and blood doesn't matter. Yes, it does, according to Paul. He says this, do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ? What do you mean by that? We are linked together with Christ because of the salvation that has taken place. And while Christ has saved my soul and I have eternal life in Christ Jesus, I understand that there is a physical component as well, where there will be an earthly resurrection and this body will come forth from the grave. It will be transformed in a twinkling of an eye and it will live in a glorified state forever in heaven. Woo. He says, do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ? Shall I then take away the members of Christ and make them members of a prostitute? I know that doesn't sound good, right? May it never be, Paul says with an exclamation point. Or do you not know that the one who joins himself to a prostitute is one body with her? That sounds terrible. For he says, the two shall become one flesh. But the one who joins himself to the Lord is one spirit with him. You will choose how you will link up in life. Will you link to Christ or will you defile your body? But he says the one who joins himself to the Lord is one spirit with him. And this is the next thing he says, flee immorality. Every other sin that a man commits is outside the body, but the immoral man sins against his own body. That is one of the most interesting verses in the New Testament. Because it speaks to the consequence of sin physically that affects a human body. You can sin all kinds of different ways, but this sin, this fornication, that in word fornication includes anything with regard to immorality, is going to be significant because it's going to affect your body in an unusual way. He says, or do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have from God, and you are not your own? I understand, if I'm reading this correctly, my body is pretty significant, isn't it? It houses the Holy Spirit of God here on this earth. Whew! Is that amazing? Then notice what he says, that last verse. You've been bought with a price. Therefore, he says, glorify God. How? In your body. The same body that's corrupted by sin. The same body that has fleshly appetites. He says, I want you to use that body to glorify God. It is possible for me living in the flesh to bring glory to God. Isn't that amazing? So God says, I want you to serve me. I want you to love me. Love me with all your heart, your soul, and your strength. But understand that if you commit sin, it will affect your body in an adverse way. And the challenge is before us today to serve the Lord and understand we can't serve the Lord while we're holding on to that sin. If you're here this morning and God's speaking to your heart, I encourage you to spend some time in prayer with the Lord. Because we can't serve the Lord on our own terms. And I know it seems like we can. Like we can just kind of decide when to flip the switch and when to flip the switch off. But God says, no. You come to me in sincerity and truth, understanding my attributes of holiness, my desire to be number one in your life, and you can serve me. He's not saying we need to be perfect. I can't say that enough. But he's saying we need to be devoted. People of Israel, choose you today whom you will serve. And your legacy will live on. Can I encourage you in the week ahead to read through the book of Judges? The last verse of the book of Judges says that every man did that which was right in his own eyes. That's bad. And that became the legacy. The people of Israel at this point in time, there is not a righteous legacy. We're still waiting for that. We see the righteousness of God. We see how all that plays out. We see the righteousness of Joshua and the elders. And then we see the people just drop off. Eventually, it would lead to kings. And we know the situation there. There's a divided kingdom eventually. And things go sideways from there with exiles that take place. It's not until Nehemiah, Ezra, and during that time period that you see a resurgence spiritually in the land. Choose you today whom you will serve. What do you want your legacy to be? Will you pray with me, please? Let's all stand and let's take a moment in time here to just bow our heads and our hearts before the Lord. If you're with us this morning and there's a question mark in your mind about where you're going to spend your eternity. You're unsure. The nature of being unsure is because of the inadequacy of what you're trusting in. It causes that uncertainty. If you're trusting in good works, you will not be certain of where you're going to spend your eternity because you frankly don't know if you've done enough of them. If you're trusting in religion, you will always wonder whether or not the religion you landed on is the right one. But if you're trusting in Jesus Christ and Him alone, you can have assurance of salvation that comes from the hand of Almighty God. The Holy Spirit of God will come in, take up residence in your life, and life will be different. The Bible promises it so. It's the reality of why the church has continued from the time of Jesus till today and why it can never be stamped out. If you're here this morning and you need to place your faith in Jesus, I invite you to do that right now in the quietness of your heart. If you're here this morning and you say, Pastor Kevin, God's dealing with my heart about some sin in my life and I want to serve the Lord, but I really haven't been, not with sincerity and truth, then get alone with God today and deal with that issue. In either of these invitations, if you have questions, you'd like to further getting some answers, you want to pray with someone, there'll be personal workers here at the front who would love to take God's word and help you today. Father in heaven, we thank you, Lord, for the words of Joshua, the testimony of Joshua. Father, we know in our heart that these are your words, that this is what you want to convey to us. And so I pray, Lord, today that we would understand the significance of exercising our will to serve you with sincerity and truth. But Father, help us to be realistic. Help us to be honest with ourselves. Help us, Father, to understand the ease of which idols creep into our lives and displace the one true God from our hearts. Help us, Lord, today to put aside those things which so easily beset us. And Father, help us to run the race in honesty before you today. Help us, Lord, I pray, to humble ourselves before you and not pretend that there are no idols in our lives. For Father, every one of us here is dealing with idols that this very hour seek to displace our God from our heart. Help us, Lord, I pray. And be with us today, Father, especially those who are not sure of their eternal destination, not sure of their relationship with Jesus. May you work in their hearts this morning, Father. And may their hearts turn to Jesus Christ and to him alone for salvation. For we're so thankful that whoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. For you have sent your only begotten Son into this world to give of his life that we might have everlasting life if we believe on him. Work in our hearts today, I pray, Father. And may the week ahead, Lord, be filled with the joy of the Lord. Father, help us, Lord, to just love you as we ought to, knowing, Lord, that these idols don't satisfy us. But help us, Father, today and this week and the months and years ahead to be satisfied with our Savior, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you.